It's a great privilege for me to introduce to you tonight our very special honored guest, Dr. Janie Harden Fritz. Dr. Fritz is a professor and the director of the Bachelor of Arts, the Master of Arts, and the PhD programs in the Duquesne Communication and Rhetorical Studies Department. She earned her Bachelor's of Arts and Master of Arts degrees in Speech Communication from the University of Georgia and her PhD in Communication Arts from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. I thought that would generate a little bit more applause for Wisconsin. I must have misinterpreted there. Her research focuses on communicative practices that constitute, sever, and restore the ties that bind individuals to the institutions of which they are a part. She is the author, co-author, or co-editor of 5 books, including Professional Civility, Communicative Virtue at Work, Communication Ethics in Crisis, Negotiating Difference in Public and Private Spheres, Problematic Relationships in the Workplace, Volumes 1 and 2, and Communication Ethics, Literacy, Dialogue, and Difference. Her most recent work focuses on the intersection of professional civility, communication ethics, and leadership practices. She is one of the most accomplished academics that I know. If you go and look at her curriculum vitae online, you will see it is 50 pages long, and on there are hundreds of publications, articles, encyclopedia entries that just give ground to the work that she has done in this field. You will also find on there a list of awards given to her for her teaching. Because she is not just an accomplished scholar, but she is a dedicated teacher and educator who gives to her students and invests in their lives and cares about them deeply. She is not only a phenomenal academic and teacher, but she is an incredibly wonderful person. It is a joy and an honor to have her with us tonight. So would you welcome my professor, Dr. Fritz.
Thank you. Thank you for that amazing welcome. My goodness. Here it is. Good evening, graduates, parents, family members, friends, and staff and leadership of Christian Life School and Journey Church. I am honored to offer the commencement address for the graduating class of 2019. I'm particularly proud to be here tonight because Dr. Bogazic is an alumnus of the Rhetoric PhD program at Duquesne University. We are so delighted to see him in leadership here. Thank you so much, Dr. Bogazic, for inviting me. And many thanks to Bethany, Coach Wells, Heidi, and all the other folks who have coordinated this event and made it possible for me to be here. I must say, too, that it's great to be back in Wisconsin after so many years. Congratulations, graduates, on this momentous occasion. You have worked hard and accomplished much. Well done. Well done. And congratulations as well to parents, grandparents, extended family, friends, teachers, and other supporters who have stood beside you and sometimes behind you, giving an occasional push of encouragement through these formative years. No success is achieved alone, which we just heard from Cameron. This moment suggests many metaphors. Opening a new chapter, continuing a journey, embarking on a bold adventure. These images evoke a vision, or invoke a vision, of what comes next. For almost all of you, that next will be pursuing higher education in one of the many fine colleges and universities in or beyond this region. Some of you will enter a time-honored trade or vocation, putting hands to work in craft or technical endeavors. It is probably the case, too, that many of you have no idea exactly what the precise details of this next will be, even if you do know exactly where you will be when summer is over. But whatever and wherever that next may be, I invite you to consider this metaphor as a guide. You will be embarking upon a quest to become your true self. Christian philosopher Caroline Simon writes of the role we play in shaping each other's lives as we pursue our destinies, what we are meant to do on this earth, our purpose, our true selves. You will be finding your true self. But note, this true self is not an individual, independent from obligations or others. It is neither selfish nor self-sufficient, but connected and cooperative. Your true self reflects a person who draws from and gives back to communities and institutions, playing a part in helping them flourish. Family, church, professional and neighborhood associations, all these strands that form the fabric of a life well lived. As we work out our personal destinies, as we pursue the quest to become our true selves, we are also working out our role in these larger concerns, these structures that are more than the sum of their parts. In the context of an understanding of human life, of the human being, the human person that gives those structures coherence and meaning, a tradition. Alasdair MacIntyre, another philosopher working from a Christian perspective, speaks of the unity or integrity of a single human life that finds coherence and meaning as part of an enduring tradition, a set of practices, activities carried out in particular ways and for particular purposes, anchored in a worldview passed down and extended through time by people who believe in what that tradition stands for, who carry out its practices, and who tell its story to the next generation. Traditions matter. What are the implications of being part of a tradition, particularly for you who are graduating? First, what comes next in your new life is not entirely new. You are not starting from scratch, building on nothing, but bringing foundational parts of the past with you. You have been equipped here at Christian Life School, academically and spiritually, to contribute to the work of the world and the kingdom of God, to participate in a tradition of faith and achieve excellence in whatever profession, occupation, or vocation calls you to be part of its ongoing story. Second, being part of a tradition gives you direction and sustenance so you can find and do what you are called to do and persevere in the doing. You will live each day guided and nourished by the meaning-rich background of faith within which ordinary tasks of life gain their significance. That's what this school has given you. You have ground under your feet, a place to stand as you face the joys and sorrows, blessings and burdens of adult life. You have a source of meaning and hope in the face of whatever life brings you, whether wanted or unwanted, planned or unplanned. And third, you represent the tradition. You are infused with it. You are walking its living story into the future, carrying its mission to places only you can go. MacIntyre reflects on what it means to live life as a standard bearer, someone who shows in everyday life the virtues that define a tradition. You are standard bearers of this institution and of the broad tradition within which it is situated, living out its virtues in your daily endeavors. A song I grew up singing, maybe you did too, or maybe your parents, maybe your grandparents, makes this point. They'll know we are Christians by our love. You are not the first to take on this task, and you will not be the last, but now it's your turn. We live in challenging times, a moment of serious disagreement in our socio-political sphere about right and wrong, good and bad, and the nature of truth and falsity. It's not always clear how to respond to circumstances, events, and people, reflecting positions completely at odds with what we believe, what we know to be right, good, and true. You may recall a scene from The Fellowship of the Rings, the second book of J.R.R. Tolkien's trilogy. Frodo is discouraged in the course of carrying out the seemingly impossible task of casting the One Ring of Power into the flames of Mount Doom to save Middle-earth from the destructive power of Sauron. Frodo says to his dear friend and mentor, Gandalf, that he wishes the ring had never come to him. He wishes that these bad things had not come to pass in his time. Gandalf offers these words in response. So do I, and so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. What will you do, graduates, with the time that is given you? What legacy will you leave as you become your true self, a standard bearer of tradition in turbulent and uncertain times? Your legacy will shape who you are, your true self, far into the future, far beyond your life on this earth, and it will give hope to others. Let's consider two figures from the Old Testament who became standard bearers of a tradition whose lives formed a unity configured within the narrative of the God of Israel, Joshua and Ruth, two persons who did something in the time given them and left enduring legacies. Their stories give us hope. I want to place them within Caroline Simon's framework of love, destiny, and imagination and reflect on how they left a legacy as part of an unfolding story that led to the New Testament and the good news of the gospel. Their stories offer wisdom for us in this moment that I invite you to put into practice as you pursue your destiny, your true self. Ruth, a widow, left her homeland to accompany Naomi, her mother-in-law, back to Naomi's hometown in Israel. How beautiful the language of the King James Version. Whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. Ruth's destiny extended down through the generations, all the way to Jesus. She saw what was possible with an imagination tempered by hardship and nurtured by love for her mother-in-law, bringing into being a family line that led to redemption. In going out to glean in the fields to provide food for herself and Naomi, by doing the very ordinary labor of life, and it was not easy, this gleaning, stooping under the hot sun to retrieve stalks of grain left by toiling reapers with little pause for rest, by bending sacrificially to this exhausting work, Ruth stepped into an unexpected love story. By heeding carefully the insightful advice from her wise mother-in-law, Ruth married Naomi's kinsman Boaz, found security for herself and her mother-in-law, and became the great-grandmother of King David. I like to think of Ruth as a model for the wife of Proverbs 31, a woman who engages in significant endeavors for her family and community, managing the buying and selling of land, manufacturing garments, running a family farm, and overseeing the complex operations of a vibrant household, as well as sharing the fruits of her labors with the poor of the city, a strong, capable, compassionate woman indeed. But consider for a moment how Ruth's faithfulness affected Naomi. Recall that Naomi had left the land of Israel accompanied by her husband and her two sons. Her husband died. Her sons married, and then her sons passed away, too, leaving her with only two Moabite daughters-in-law. She was bereft and disillusioned, going so far as to tell everyone, once she returned to her hometown, "Just call me bitter. The Lord has taken everything from me." Even the wisest among us can be tempted to despair. By the end of the story, though, this bitter woman, Mara, is pleasant again. She is Naomi again, her true self, thanking God for the blessings he has bestowed upon her. especially for that little grandson, Obed. Ruth helped restore Naomi's relationship to God. Ruth shaped Naomi's destiny, just as Naomi shaped Ruth's. Joshua, a figure appearing earlier in Old Testament history, loved God and the people of Israel. His destiny was to lead the exiles from Egypt into the promised land. He stood as a role model of obedience to God and his laws. With imagination given clarity and endurance through his apprenticeship to Moses from the first Passover onward, not only observing the miraculous acts of God on behalf of his people, but witnessing them, making them part of his very being and believing in the remarkable power and love that brought them forth, Joshua forged a nation that exists to this day. Okay, now picture this. Moses stretches out his staff, the sea parts, the Israelites go through on dry land, walls of water on either side. Does Joshua think, oh, that's nice, a meteorological phenomenon has happened. We're going across the sea on dry land. How about that? Whatever. Meh. I think he probably thought, oh my goodness, this is amazing. Look at what God is doing for us. This is wonderful. Wow, if God can do this, he can do anything. I'm throwing in my lot with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's the difference that makes the difference. Of course, Joshua still had to deal with the everyday issues of being Moses' assistant. He knew the challenges Moses faced leading God's people through the wilderness, and he experienced those challenges himself in his early years. You'll recall that it was Joshua, supported by Caleb, who offered a minority opinion after he, Caleb, and the rest of the Israeli scouts returned from their foray into Canaan. The majority fixated on the strength and size of the inhabitants rather than on the power of God and the richness of the land, and died in the desert. They had only observed what God had done. 40 years later, still strong, Joshua led the people of Israel to their homeland in fulfillment of a covenant, finishing the work Moses started, and Caleb was right there with him. Joshua's path was not easy. He encountered difficulties, failures, and challenges at every turn. Joshua had to deal with conflicts, honor commitments that should never have been taken on in the first place, resolve issues of distributing land among a huge number of people, and keep up everyone's energy and resolve to go in and claim the land they had been bequeathed, which was beginning to look like a lot of work. Joshua took a stand to serve the God of Israel with courage and conviction. Hear his vow echoing through the ages. Choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your forefathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What can these figures offer you as you pursue your quest for your true self, as you take those next steps into the future? I'll highlight just a few insights to which we may all attend. Find good companions, trusted others who will support you as you pursue the good and help you stay faithful. You will help them as well. A cord of many strands is not easily broken. Caroline Simon speaks of the role of imagination in seeing what others may become, even when they themselves cannot see it. If you've seen the movie October Sky, and if you haven't, you should watch it, you'll remember how Homer Hickam, now a well-known author, and his friends worked together to learn rocketry, winning first place in the National Science Fair and going on to college against all odds. They did it together, supporting each other through good times and bad. Joshua was surely encouraged by Caleb, and Ruth and Naomi helped and strengthened one another. Be of service to others. With burden comes meaning. What we do for others makes a difference and ripples out in ways we may never know. Be the difference in someone's life. Back down in Georgia, where my family still resides, my nephew Tim visits his homebound father every week, bringing him groceries and making sure he's okay. I said to Tim the other day, "This is so much for you to do, Tim. It's such a burden." He said to me, "I know it's a burden, but I'm glad to do it. I'm glad to be able to help. My nephew Tim is making a difference in my brother's life and in mine. Joshua and Ruth lived lives of service, each in different contexts, both in significant ways. They made a difference. Lead boldly, follow faithfully, and heed good advice, resisting majority opinion when it is in error. If the way seems unclear for the moment, take time to get your bearings and move forward in confidence and hope. The most direct way may not be the best. Another reminder from Tolkien is apt here. Not all those who wander are lost. Joshua wasn't just wandering around in circles at Jericho, leading the people aimlessly around the city. Ruth's presence in Boaz's field was not a chance event as she took the initiative, the leaderly initiative, to gather grain. Joshua voted with the minority against the faithless naysayers. Ruth chose otherwise than convention, seeking out the older Boaz rather than the younger men most youthful widows would have considered. When disappointment and sadness come your way and things don't work out as expected, do all that you can do. And in so doing, you will find a way forward. Learn from past difficulties, push off from them, and put them to use. That's the way out of whatever dark place may have claimed you for the moment. Joshua and Ruth did what they could do. They persevered and found their destinies, their true selves. Read the signs. Don't miss the miraculous in what appear to be everyday events. And when the truly extraordinary happens, and it will, receive that gift with faith, and it will sustain you at just the right moment. Both the ordinary and the extraordinary offer opportunities to strengthen faith when received as a blessing from God. Whether leading an army to great conquests or going out to put food on the table, find the gift in the moment. Take nothing for granted. Joshua and Ruth have much to teach us on this score. Finally, stay rooted in this tradition and live out its virtues as your true self. How you respond to life sends a powerful message. We are called to be standard bearers of faith, Christ bearers, lamp holders in a confused and hurting world. I offer this poem I wrote for you, graduates, in honor of the occasion of the class of 2019 of Christian Life School. You'll have to see if it scans. Although I know few, if any, of you by name, I know the stuff of which you're made. For this good ground on which you stand, a clue to who you are. Your hearts will neither fade nor falter when you run into a wall of difficulty and you cannot pass. You'll stand firm, keep your footing, and not fall, all of you in this graduating class. You'll just keep moving, never slacking pace, and somehow it will yield. The strength's not yours, but God's. You bear the standard of this place from here on out. Now watch as he outpours amazing grace and peace upon your days, and you will keep his word and keep his ways. As you take those next steps, remember Ruth and Joshua, who speak to us still. Go be the difference in the world, and God bless you all.